really the West. And there's some changes now with that. Seattle's launched a pre-K program. But we really see pre-K policymakers have consistently, in diverse states across the country, seen pre-K as a mechanism to help boost early skills of 3- and 4-year-olds. So what does the research say? I've been privileged for the last number of years to work on a long-term follow-up of one particular pre-K program in Tulsa, Oklahoma. In Oklahoma, it was the second state to adopt universal pre-K. That's pre-K that is available for all 4-year-olds, regardless of income, of language background, et cetera. It is not compulsory. So like in West Virginia, you can enroll in it. You don't have to enroll in it. And it is also delivered almost exclusively through public schools. So, and teachers have to be paid on the same wage. They have the same requirements as any other teacher in the elementary school. And there are very high other inputs, such as student-teacher ratios and things like that. So it's really one of the models in the country for universal pre-K. So early results of this study did show impressive early boosts in terms of cognitive skills and some social-emotional as well. We followed them now into middle school, asking the question, with this program, do we see the same effects continue into middle school? And these next couple slides show some promising results. So what we did find is that for math achievement test scores, that children are performing significantly better by 7th grade. We also see that 33% fewer children are actually retained in grade from kindergarten through the end of middle school, which is a significant difference and also has a real potential to be a cost-saving mechanism for these districts who are implementing pre-K. Because as you know, if a kid is in school another year, you're going to be paying for that child to be in school another year. If you got pre-K and the kids aren't retained, you're not going to have to contend with that. However, our study and our program is not the only program out there. So this is a randomized control trial conducted by a number of people at Vanderbilt University and in Tennessee, they have a targeted universal program that's income tested, so it's only for low-income children. They randomly assign children to this program and some to not be enrolled in the program, and they followed them from kindergarten into middle school. And yes, these results are about as sad as you can imagine. So you do see that early boost in when they are 5 years old, that's age, on the x-axis. But what you see is by the end of elementary school, those effects have really converged. You don't see those kids performing as well as, you don't see them performing any better than the peers who were not in pre-K. And these are, you know, students with similar background characteristics. Okay, so what do we make of these findings? These are two different programs in two different states, and how do we make sense of this, and how do states and municipalities decide whether or not to put support behind pre-K education? I think the most important thing to remember, so I'm a developmental psychologist, so I think about the whole child. So when I think about these results, I have to think about children and where they are. So these are two pictures of two very different places, Camden, New Jersey, and Marblehead, Massachusetts, a very affluent suburb of Boston. So imagine for a moment if pre-K didn't exist. If there was no pre-K, if there was no Head Start, if families and children had to figure out a place for their 4-year-olds to access care or educational experiences. I think we can all agree that if there was no such thing as pre-K, that it would be difficult to level the playing field for children in these vastly different contexts with vastly different resources and experiences for them to be exposed to. So I still think that the jury's still out and there needs to be a lot of more high quality research done considering where kids are and the types of pre-K programs, but I am encouraged by a lot of the results and I'm excited to keep doing this work. Thank you.
So thanks to Dr. Anderson for that. You may be wondering if there's going to be an opportunity to ask questions of any of our presenters. just ask that you save your questions to the end. We'll mingle a bit. We have lunch next door at noon, so maybe you'll have a chance to ask some questions of our presenters, but save all of your questions. We're going to have Dr. Brigandi, Carla Brigandi, who's our next speaker.
Hi, get used to this. Hi, I'm Carla Brigandi, and I'm going to be talking to you today about giftedness, the myths, and the realities. So before we get started, I want all of you to think of someone whom you would consider to be gifted. And now I want you to identify the reasons why you selected that person. Are they intelligent, kind, athletic, musical? Are they good leaders? What makes giftedness, and more importantly, why do we care? In the early 1900s, a man by the name of Lewis Terman decided that giftedness was a measure of IQ, which is the ability to process, store, and retrieve information. And he hypothesized that the higher a person's IQ was, that the more eminent that person would be in life. Terman thought it was important to identify children with the potential to be gifted, because then we could create environments that would nurture those talents and they would be more likely to manifest. That would be really good for the kid, but it would also be really good for society. So he set about to prove his hypothesis, and he identified 1,500 children with IQs that ranged between 135 and 200 as measured by a test that he created, the Stanford-Binet. Terman found that many of his students did indeed have very successful lives. They were more educated and better adjusted than the average person. However, many of them went on to be scientists, they were scholars, and you may have heard of Lee Cronbach, known for Cronbach's Alpha, who was one of Terman's termites, as the study participants were affectionately dubbed. However, not all of the termites achieved eminence. Some of them went on to lead what would be considered very normal lives, and some struggled with personal problems and alcoholism. It seemed that high IQ alone wasn't the recipe for eminence. Further complicating it were Luis Alvarez and William Shockley. Luis Alvarez and William Shockley were smart guys. They had really high IQs, and in fact, they were in the original talent pool. However, they did not have IQs high enough to become termites, and yet they won the Nobel Prize in Physics. And Terman had to admit this was a level of eminence that had not been achieved by any of the termites. And so this started the discussion. If giftedness is not IQ alone, then what is it? And a number of theorists started researching. And Carol Dweck said, you know, it's having a growth mindset instead of a fixed mindset. And Sandy Kaplan would say, it's the ability to think with depth and complexity. Sternberg said, maybe it's wisdom. Tannenbaum said, you know, there's an element of chance in this, chance that you're born into a society that recognizes your talents and appreciates them, chance that you're born into a family that has the means to support you. Joe Renzulli said that giftedness is the combination of a cluster of three interacting traits: above average ability, creativity, and task commitment. And Joe Renzulli would further say that when these things happen at the same time, gifted behaviors manifest. Giftedness is not a noun, it's not a person. Giftedness is a behavior that happens in some people under certain circumstances and at certain times, because nobody's gifted in all things at all moments. And it's this under certain circumstances that we as educators and as a society need to look at. How do we create these circumstances that help children with potential develop that potential, all children? And why does it matter when we talk about gifted kids? Because gifted kids are indeed different from their same age peers. They may have precocious language and thought. So think back to that traditional measure of IQ that Terman was looking at. That's the ability to process information more rapidly than their same age peers. They can store more information and they can retrieve it more quickly Imagine them in a general education classroom. They may have logical thinking. They care about cause and effect. This is the child that's always saying, but why, but why, but why? They may show early ability in art, in math, in music. Think of a child prodigy. They may be motivated and persistent. They don't give up, the toddler who empties out the kitchen cabinets. And they may have advanced interest, which doesn't always bode well with their same age peers who don't want to talk about thermodynamics in the sandbox. They have superior humor. A kindergarten teacher once told me how she asked one of her students to pass the cup, and he put the cup on the floor and proceeded to walk back and forth. He was passing the cup. They might have high empathy and moral thinking, and a friend of mine told me he was walking his son to the bus stop one day, and he was holding his son's hand, but as kids are prone to do, his son let go of his hand, ran across the street, narrowly being missed by an oncoming car. We've all had those moments. He walked over to him and grabbed his shoulders, and with his heart pounding, he knelt down and said, "Colby, you have got to look both ways before you cross the street. You could have been killed." And Colby looked at him and said, "You know, Dad, I'm not really afraid of dying, but I think Mommy would be really sad." So why do we care about what giftedness is? I mean, really, in this society where we're trying to create equity, wouldn't our limited resources be better used to help underachieving kids? Won't gifted children be okay anyway? That's the prevailing myth. And although gifted underachievement sounds like an oxymoron, studies show that up to 50% of gifted children are not achieving to their potential. In addition to that, a large number of students who fail to complete high school test in the gifted range. Further complicating this is what Stanford University calls the vexing legend of Lewis Terman legacy. What I didn't tell you earlier was the name of Terman's study, which was the genetic study of genius. And like the name implies, it was rooted in eugenics. Kids in Terman's study were white, upper socioeconomic level, and mostly male. It didn't take into account culturally different learners, English language learners, twice exceptional, and low socioeconomic learners. And this is important because reliance on an IQ score, even though Terman disproved it, is still happening. It's still the way that we're identifying gifted children, even though we know that there's a bias inherent in the test, and even though we know that IQ alone, it is a factor, an important factor, but not the deciding factor of giftedness. So warranted charges of elitism have caused some to call for the elimination of gifted programs. Unfortunately, that hurts the children who need it most, because our high ability children from underserved populations are even more likely than their more advantaged peers to underachieve, to not go to college, and to not graduate from high school. By cutting gifted programs, you're really taking services from the kids who would benefit from them most. And why does this matter? That was best said by the words of the late Jim Gallagher, who said, "Failure to help the gifted child is a societal tragedy, the extent of which is difficult to measure, but is what is surely great. How can we measure the sonata unwritten, the curative drug undiscovered, the absence of political insight? They are the difference between what we are and what we could be as a society." And how I end all my lectures is to remind everybody that they have three obligations: develop your talents, pass on what you learn, and leave the world a better place. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Brigandi. Okay, at this point in the program, I hope to be able to announce our undergraduate poster winners, but I don't see my judging coordinator, Dr. Patchen. So we're going to press on with our third Ed Talk, and that is Dr. Stephanie Lorenz and her colleagues.
So, Raise your hand if you're a dancer. That's amazing to me, because if you asked a five-year-old that same question, all of them would raise their hands with energy oozing out of every fingertip. But isn't it odd that even over one decade, by the time those same kindergartners are 15, the majority of them have come to discover dance as something larger than themselves. Along the way, most of us have done just that. Most of us have discounted being a dancer, and it breaks my heart. As a mom, as a teacher educator, along the way, dance has disconnected from us. Maybe because of accessibility issues, maybe because of gender stereotypes, cultural beliefs, body shaming. Along the way, dance has become something bigger than it should be. So I'm going to call on you today to audition your mind. And be just what our schools need. Now, most people won't tell you that they're opposed to the arts in schools. In fact, 93% of Americans agree. I'll just go on and hope that it works later. It's not a big deal if it doesn't. 93% of Americans. Belief in its practice, one of which is the hierarchy that exists between the arts and schools, especially within the arts. Now, I imagine everyone in this room had a visual art experience in their K-12 schooling, and the majority of you have probably had a music experience. And yes, this includes playing one of those confounded plastic recorders. However, residing at the bottom of the arts hierarchy are theater and lastly, dance. And I ask you to question why. Dance has the capacity to teach us to take risks, to work as a core, to focus on process and not just product. Dance is a form of literacy. Dance is social, it's historical, it's cultural, it's physical, but it's also academic. Dance education offers complex ways and unique ways to represent ideas, like John Bohannon does in his TED Talk, Dance Your PhD. All kids need experience in this. And so we need to think about what dance education is, but I'm not talking about being a trained dancer. For some, that's a major barrier. It includes a black leotard, standing at the bar with your hair in a bun, much like Missy Copeland, who in 2015 was the first ever black dancer to earn the role of principal dancer in American Ballet Theater. And for others, it's someone like Savion Glover, clad in tap shoes and hoofing with precision. But I think we really need to shift our understanding of what it means to be a dancer. We need to think about where dance happens, why dance happens, and all the spaces where we can welcome dance. For this, we need a dance education. Dance education includes things like learning how and practicing body spelling with your bodies. It includes things like a folk dance from Israel.
My, 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 my.
It includes a partner dance in salsa. It includes a modern piece about living with Alzheimer's. Dance education is for the second grader who can't sit still. It's for the middle schooler who struggles with anxiety. It's for the disenfranchised high schooler and the girl in the next room with autism. Dance education is for everyone. In 2012, I had the opportunity to be part of the West Virginia Department of Education's elementary dance pilot, where we worked with Title I schools across the state of West Virginia to integrate dance with reading language arts and also mathematics. It was a wonderful experience, and if I can go back one slide, and we'll be on cue here. Back. I'm sorry. The picture that will pop up is actually one of our Mon County partner schools. And it was a really powerful experience for so many students. And in fact, even though this is a picture of one of our schools in Mon County, I want to share with you what a special educator said from North Jefferson Elementary. She had this to say: "I surmised that my students with autism would not want to participate. With issues such as sensitivity to touch and sound, I thought that they would protest an all-out tantrum. Much to my surprise, they were eager to do what everybody else was doing and soon discovered that it was a safe place to take a risk. It was an opportunity for them to socialize with their peers and develop competencies in self-confidence, self-control, and collaboration." Now, not only is dance a powerful way for students to engage, it's an interesting way to connect what Paul Gorski calls the opportunity gap for students living in poverty. He has noted that in-school access to quality dance education, arts education, has a motivating effect on students and overall learning climate. I've had the opportunity to experience this firsthand when Kevin, a 10th grade transfer student from an inner city school in Baltimore, showed up to my dance class during his second semester in a small West Virginia high school. Now, Kevin, most people wrote Kevin off when they saw him, especially after they heard him. And I think it's really interesting how linguistically biased we are, but that's another ed talk, right? Kevin surprised people that semester, and he made me immensely proud. While his first semester didn't yield great results, he didn't miss a single day of his second semester, and I'm not joking, I'm not kidding at all. And this was brought up at a faculty meeting one Friday. I talked to Kevin later about this, and I said, "Why the change? Is everything okay?" He just looked at me and he said, "Well, Miss Morris, I wouldn't want to miss a dance class." And I smiled back at him because I knew that there was truth in that statement. Dance class was the one place in that building where Kevin felt at home, the one place where he was accepted for who he was. All kids need that. All kids need an opportunity to have a dance education. Dance education is very complex. It includes things like practicing spelling with your body, it includes things like exploring wavelengths with locomotor movements and levels. It includes exploring shapes and patterns in a three-dimensional space. It includes things like creating a movement piece based on a creative writing work and using a creative work to motivate a movement piece. And sometimes, just sometimes, dance education is about being present in the movement. We need to challenge the idea of what it means to be a dancer and where dance happens and what that is. We need to audition our minds. We need to consider deeply how dance can impact our lives, our children's lives, and empower us in so many ways. So I ask you again, are you a dancer? Thank you. Very, very quick thank you to these guys who volunteered their time. Each one of these students actually took my dance and movement in schools class, and they're all our students in CEHS. We have two students who are graduating for the first ever cohort of the four-year program, Brianna Moore and Ryan Welsh. And then we also have two students from the five-year teacher education program. Libby is graduating and this year. And then we have Emily Elkin as well, and she will be graduating in a couple years, all our elementary education majors.
Did you change up the piece? He's back. You have to turn that.
Hello? Yes, that's better. Thank you all for being here today. I want to thank so many of my students that are in my land-grant college and university class. I know these are some of the themes that we talked about. They have a running bet that I can do anything in 7 minutes. So we'll see how I'm able to do, but it's a real honor to be here with you all and to hear some of the fine work that folks are doing. What I want to talk about today is something that we're all living, of course, the economic challenges in West Virginia, the challenges that we've experienced in demographic challenges and an aging population, increased medical costs. We've had a decrease in economic or decrease in energy production. No matter what the administration says, this is not all due to environmental regulations, due to automation and other issues. And all these things have contributed to the depressed budget or difficult budget environment that we face today. I know in our keynote address, we're going to hear about some of the, some of the after effects of what we have seen in privatization in American public higher education across the country. But I just want to talk about some very specific things here in the West Virginia context, because we have seen that, with the difficult budget environment, higher education has been on the chopping block, resulting, of course, in increased tuition. So in addition to some of those traditional drivers of a challenging budget situation, I also want to discuss another one that I don't think has gotten enough press or that we've talked about when we've addressed the budget, and that's what I would call misguided economic development strategies, or the tax cuts that we've seen starting in 2007, which had deprived the state of significant revenue. Just last year, Senator Manchin, former Governor Manchin, said he has started to have second thoughts of whether the tax cuts from 2007 were a good idea. I would agree they were not a good idea. But I also want to propose an alternative. I want to talk about some of the things we do in the Center for the Future of Land-Grant Universities to think about some of the ways that public higher education institutions can realign some of their activities to contribute to greater economic development in our states, and also encourage resistive, sometimes, state legislatures to invest in higher education. Do we have any legislators here today? I just gave a talk in New Hampshire, and after I beat up on the legislature for 20 minutes, I found out there were 5 of them in the audience, so I just wanted to, just how friendly the crowd was. Okay, hold on. I was promised a mic up here for my TED talk, so I don't have enough. So these are 2 numbers I want you to look at. This is the current budget deficit in that we've been talking about a lot in the newspapers over the last year. This number oscillates a little bit. But this is what we were faced with, a $540 million budget deficit in fiscal year 2018. That's on top of a $466 million deficit in 2017 and $195 million deficit in 2016. We've, of course, the governor was here recently. He had talked about some of the increasing ways to increase revenue in his budget. Of course, the state legislature has been quite opposed to some of those revenue increasing strategies. But this is where we are. This is the number we're trying to tackle. The second number, the $415 million, is what we lose, what we have lost annually, or what we're losing annually right now in revenue from some of the tax cuts that began in 2007, the elimination of the business franchise tax, decrease in the corporate tax rate, and there's also some other smaller tax cuts that are part of that. Right now, in the current year, we are at the lowest revenue collection level as a share of the West Virginia economy that we've had in 25 years. Okay, so my point of saying that is We hear a lot about raising costs, and this is, you know, just shows that our revenue collection is down significantly. Can't work it. Am I hitting the wrong thing? Oh, I'm supposed to. Oh, right. Okay. I'm sorry. Does this guy really work here? This guy. Okay. So what that has meant for higher education institutions, this includes some of the current proposed cuts, $120 million in higher education, with $12 million proposed, $6 million, of course, going to being cut to West Virginia University. In response, West Virginia higher education institutions since 2008 have increased tuition by 42.4% to make up for some of those budget shortfalls. Of course, the $12 million in cuts to higher education is part of the governor's budget. Some of the things we're hearing from the state legislature is additional $50 to $70 million in cuts to higher education. So, you know, if you're taking this, you know, why have we seen this decrease, you know, in revenue? The idea has been that those decreased, you know, a more competitive corporate business environment will attract business, will reverse some of our unemployment, will increase economic activity. Some of the things we work on in the Center for the Future of Land-Grant Universities is to propose an alternative for economic development strategies in our states. Our president, Gordon Gee, is, you know, has been very engaged in this process over the last year, has been talking a lot about the 10-to-1 return on investment that we see when we put money into public higher education, you know, as far as investment in human capital, economic multipliers, and so forth. But what we're saying now goes beyond this. You know, we're really asking the question of how can our land-grant universities restructure their core activities to not only contribute to a message for our legislature of economic development and growth, but actually restructure the way we do our work to promote economic development. So in 2015, the APLU, the Association of Public and Land-Grant Universities, their Commission on Innovation, Competitiveness, and Economic Prosperity produced the Economic Engagement Framework as a set of tools that can help universities plan, implement, assess, and advance economic engagement efforts. 60 universities have already applied for this designation, and this is a ongoing effort for institutions to think about the work that they're doing in the area of economic engagement. You could see here that our traditional model of teaching, research, and service can be represented in these three bubbles. You know, we used to think of economic engagement as a fourth mission, you know, as commercial application of our work or thinking about economic activity as a fourth thing that we do. This framework is really challenging institutions to think about those spaces of overlap of developing human capital or developing talent from undergrads to 2 years, from cradle to the grave, from innovation to not only our basic research to applied research to innovation and commercial application, but also community development. So yes, we've always done service as land-grant institutions. We've been engaged with places through extension. But putting on a framework of economic activity and how do we contribute to the develop of the capacities of communities, not just investing in things like broadband, but also the fine arts and making our communities places that attract workers to move to West Virginia and engage in entrepreneurial activities or be part of new business opportunities in their communities. So finally, I want to leave you with, you know, some examples. We've seen, you know, there's great classic examples out, you know, California and the role that the University of California played in the development of Silicon Valley and biotechnology research. We have North Carolina's technology triangle. We have states building innovation parks and in partnership with their land-grant institutions. But here in Appalachia, we also have things that are much closer. In Kentucky, we see interesting programs about how to retrain out-of-work coal miners into coders in partnerships between land-grant institution and community college and public schools, investment in broadband, computer scientists out in the field, working with teacher educators, all with a common goal of providing much needed economic development in that area of Appalachia. Of course, here in West Virginia, you know, we've had a strong tradition of close linkages between our WVU clinical and pharmacological research and some of our biomedical and pharmaceutical industries. We've seen extension and faculty members rethink their work of outreach with the most recent flood, thinking it not just as something to go help those people in that part of the state recover, but actually take seriously what the institution can do in partnership with those areas to rebuild the economic viability. So if this is just going to be more than a slogan, as I say to my students, are we just renaming what we've done or just providing a slogan for the legislature? We have to get serious about reorganizing some of the work that we do at our institutions. Faculty must be willing to innovate. They must be willing to work across their disciplinary boundaries, get outside the ivory tower and find those spaces where practical problems exist. We must be willing to reimagine traditional service. The service that faculty do must not only be your 10% on the P&T committee. We must think about service as engaged in our community or working in engaged scholarship. But at the same time, leadership must go beyond just talking about recognizing this work and actually changing promotion and tenure criteria, incentivizing the type of work that gets faculty and other staff out in the community to engage in the real, serious, and systemic problems that we have in our communities. And finally, we must integrate community partnerships and services into our student learning activities. Look at the problems that we have out there in West Virginia as a real learning opportunity that can be integrated in part of our undergraduate education or graduate research opportunities. We hope that such a transformation can encourage our state legislatures to recognize that we are a better bet, that investing in land-grant universities is a better bet in improving the economic standing of our states than what has proved to be a failure of a consistent reliance on tax cuts. Thank you.
So that was Dr. Nate Sorber. We are still waiting for our judges with the final tallies for our poster presentations. I suspect there's some Russian involvement. So if you'll just bear with us for a bit. So we have one final Ed Talk this morning, and that will be Dr. Jessica Troilo. Jessica? Where are you at? There you are. Oh my God.
Good afternoon. Oh, there it goes. So I study fathers, and I'm excited about being able to talk to you about a little bit about what I do.
So the first study that I did that involved fathers was when I was in grad school, and I wanted to understand cultural perceptions of different types of fathers. And one of the things that I found was that divorced fathers are perceived overwhelmingly negatively. And so not only are they assumed to be absent from their families, when they are around, they're kind of thought to be pretty bad fathers. And this is in addition to perceptions that they're bad providers and just in general, bad people. And so I explained this within the bounds of the study and kind of moved on and didn't really think about this again until I started co-facilitating a mandatory divorce parent education class where I had divorcing and divorced fathers, and their behaviors were pretty different than what the perceptions were. And so while I had some fathers who acted like they didn't want to be there or that they didn't care, I had a lot more who were angry that they couldn't see their kids or who were sad and would cry throughout the class about what was going on in their families, and others just wanted to share stories about what their kids do. And I couldn't figure out what was going on here. Why are perceptions so negative and the behaviors not matching up? And the conclusion that I eventually came to was what I still think now, that divorced fathers are often misunderstood and left behind and sometimes even left out of research and practice. And so in the next 8 minutes, I'll talk a little bit more about what I mean by that, but also give you some examples of what it looks like when we include divorced fathers, because I think the easiest way to increase divorced involvement, divorced father involvement, is to include them in the discussion of divorced parenthood. So fathers weren't really studied by family scholars until about the 1970s. And so this was only married fathers, though. Researchers assumed that divorced fathers were absent and so didn't need to be included in research about parenthood. Now, this, of course, changed, but early research on divorced fathers essentially asked, why aren't they involved more, which still assumes that they weren't involved enough, but also assumes that there's this finite amount of involvement and that if fathers would just get that amount, whatever it was, then they could easily go from the uninvolved to the involved category. Currently, the research that divorced father scholars rely on has been based almost exclusively on mother reports of their ex-husband's behaviors. And so divorced fathers can be hard to get in terms of research. And so what researchers have done is thought, well, we can get mothers and ask them to think about what they think their ex-husbands do with their kids when they're in the other house. and we thought this is okay, or researchers thought this is okay, and it's really not. And if we think, and I don't know another body of research where this happens, and if we think that divorced fathers don't know that they've been left out of research about them, they do, and they're pretty angry about it because they have a lot to say. And so I'll share some of their stories with you today. But currently there's a push to get more stories and voices from divorced fathers out into research. And so we're committing to doing that. Involved divorced fathers have strong opinions about uninvolved divorced fathers. So like any negatively stereotyped group, they're aware of their stereotypes and they're angry at those who act in ways consistent with the deadbeat dad stereotype. And what I hear most often from the fathers that I've talked with is this notion that they somehow prioritize kids differently than uninvolved fathers do. And this looks different, obviously, based on the father that we talked to. But one father told me about how he was in a serious relationship with a woman who ended up getting transferred out of state for work. And the decision was to either go with her and keep the relationship going or stay where he was and essentially have the relationship end. And he said the decision was pretty easy because I knew if I would go out of state, I'd miss time with my kids, so the relationship ended. Other fathers will completely put their personal lives on hold, at least in the short term, until they can see that their kids have adjusted to the divorce. Other fathers take a more financial reprioritization of their families, and so one dad said, you know, I only eat ramen noodles and peanut butter and jelly sandwiches when my kids aren't with me, so I can save money so that when my kids are, I can buy healthy, nutritious, high-quality foods. And this was a dad who we could easily classify as upper middle class, and who I did classify in that category, but divorce is expensive. And he said that my kids shouldn't have to suffer a change in their standard of living because of a decision I had made. Divorced fathers also talk about, who are, remain involved, also talk about understanding divorced parenthood as a whole different thing than married parenthood. And a lot of them talk about the divorce with gratitude. And so they'll say things like this: the divorce really gave them an opportunity to think about the kind of father that I need to be now. And when I say they think about it with gratitude, it's not the same as them being happy or excited that they're divorced somewhere, but most think about the divorce as an opportunity for change and one that they wouldn't have taken had they not gone through this process. And so one father was really excited to tell me this story about how he took his son to the ER. And he quickly clarified, well, I wasn't excited that my son was in the ER, but I like that I got to take him. He said, I got to make the decision about whether or not the fall was serious enough to require a trip to the ER. When I got there, the doctors talked to me. They gave me the aftercare plan for what needs to happen. And then I got to talk to my former spouse about what we need to do now. And he said, if I was married, this never would have happened. My wife would have handled all of that. He said, never once when I was married did a teacher call and ask to talk to me, or did a doctor talk to me. It was always my wife at the time. And he said, I really like this, being kind of in charge, and this feeling of being that I'm the primary parent. And every father I've talked with has some story where they realize that they're now the primary parent, and really liking that. And for this father in particular, he felt a sense of confidence that he could do this parenting thing. He knew that his son could feel that he could count on him if he needed anything. He felt closer to his son. I don't know how his son felt, but at least for this father, it felt like this was a turning point for him and his son's relationship. And like I said, every father that I talked with had some story where they realized, I'm now the primary parent and I need to step up or I'm not doing my job. And one father said, you know, it's like I'm a full-time parent, but part of the time. And we would miss all these stories if we didn't go out to the fathers and ask them for what they've experienced. And so I'll leave you with this. Andrew Cherlin said that men today are better fathers when they're around and worse when they're not. And he's right. Just as I provided examples of involved fathers, I could have easily given you examples of uninvolved fathers. But here's the good news. There are more people working today to help support divorced father involvement than has ever been true before. And that's especially true for Mon County and other parts of West Virginia as well. And so while we have a long way to go increasing divorced father involvement across all divorced fathers, I think that by doing so, we'll be creating healthier, stronger families. And I think that's what we're all here for at the end of the day, is to help create, sustain, and support healthy, strong families. Thank you.
Okay, well, how about a really nice round of applause for all of our presenters today and our dancers as well. Thank you all. A really excellent set of presentations. So thanks to all of you as well for being here. If you'll just bear with us for a few more moments, we're letting the anticipation build for announcements of the winning posters. So the judges told me they're this close. So. In just a few moments, I think we could probably have some questions for our presenters while we've got some time. If anybody would like to ask questions of any of the presenters, anyone? Bueller? Okay, well then just sit tight, folks. It'll be just a few minutes. Okay, welcome back, everyone. I have the results of our judging for the poster presentations this morning, and so I'll begin with the child development posters, the nursery school, preschool posters, which is a separate category, and so we had three place winners. Our third place winner, and this was for $50, is Catherine Alder. Catherine here. And she, along with our other winners, will receive a College of Education t-shirt, hashtag go first. Many of you already have these shirts, which are a really hot item. That's why there are boxes of them in my office. Our second place winner, and this will be an award of $100, is Katie Holdren. Katie Holdren. Katie. And our first place winner, Emily Pearson. Emily, very good. And that is a $200 prize. Okay. All right, moving on to the regular or general category of posters. First, our undergraduate awards. We had a tie for second place, or maybe it was a tie for third place. I'll let you all sort that out. So that tie for second place, which is, I believe, a $100 prize, if my memory is correct. Audrey Weiss and her colleagues, I don't have all of their names, I'm sorry, but you can look in your program. Audrey Weiss, and also Melissa Barrow and Jackie Smith. So congratulations to those folks. And our undergraduate winner, best poster presentation, Haley Glover, for $200. Okay, and now our graduate student research posters. Third place for $100, Hannah Stone. Congratulations. In second place, Lydia Olson for $200. And our winner, our graduate student research poster presentation winner, Timothy Swiger. And that's for $300. So congratulations, Timothy. I expect you to buy me a drink later. Can I say that? No, okay. That was my boss talking there. No, I can't say that. So strike that on the video. Edit that out. Also, Timothy is the winner of our oral presentation, best oral presentation winner. And there's some cash award with that as well. I don't remember how much it is. So double congratulations to Timothy. I'm informed we have a snack lunch. I think that's different from a lunch, a snack lunch. So that's next door where the posters were presented. So you are welcome to join us for a snack lunch. Whenever I go to visit my wife's family, we have this rule, you know, whenever there's a lot of company and not much food, it's called family hold back. So faculty, that means you don't eat, and our students and guests will. So, all right. At 1 o'clock, at 1 o'clock sharp, our keynote speaker, Dr. Sarah Goldrick-Robb, will deliver our keynote. So please stick around for that. It's going to be very exciting, very fun. So thanks a lot.